Jerry Punch of ABC and ESPN was a quarterback for Lou Holtz at NC State. Is a medical doctor, and his ER experience has actually come into play in his NASCAR career with a couple of drivers, Dr. Punch being the first one on response, but was in, is it Bunnell, Florida, right between St. Augustine and Daytona Beach as an ER doctor. Now lives in the Knoxville area, has done college football, was a part of my personal favorite college football team of all time, the old Thursday night crew with Mike Tirico and Lee Corso and Kirk Herbstreit and Dr. Punch on the sidelines. But has done a variety of sports. When ESPN lost the NASCAR contract, of all their NASCAR guys, they kept one. And that was Dr. Punch, who continues to serve in those great roles today. Ladies and gentlemen, from ABC and ESPN, Dr. Jerry Punch.
Thank you very much. I was telling the folks I can't wear this tie on the road, they won't let me, but I can wear it. I can show my colors when I'm home. Hey, thanks for having me here today. And thank you, Coach Toronto. I appreciate that. When I travel and speak, they tell you you're supposed to, if you look at the books, they're supposed to open the speech with something funny, something humorous. And being the ESPN guy, you're supposed to be able to give breaking news. Well, there is no breaking news that's that critical today. So I found out, I don't know how many of you ever heard of this guy named Russell Larson. Russell Larson from Logan, Utah. Now, he won the award this past week for the coolest headstone. Now, by the fact that he won the coolest headstone indicates he didn't celebrate because he's dead. Okay. But the coolest headstone award goes to Russell Larson of Logan, Utah. And on his headstone it says, these are the five rules for men to follow for a happy life. And rule one was, it's important to have a woman who helps at home, cooks from time to time, cleans up, and has a job. Number two, it's important to have a woman who can make you laugh. That's great. Number three, it's important to have a woman you can trust and doesn't lie to you. And number four, it's important to have a woman who is very good when it comes to the intimate times. And number five, it's very important that these four women never meet. Or you'll end up dead just like me. That's okay. Russell Larson. It is great to be here today, and I love... and I want to share with you a couple stories in a few minutes, but I want to start out talking about, how blessed I am. I love living in this community. I'm thrilled that we had Dave Serrano back here, and I know you are as well. And I can't wait. I'm off this weekend. I can't wait for Ole Miss to come to town so I get a chance to watch them in person. I love listening on the radio. John Wilkerson does a fabulous job. I keep telling my colleagues at ESPN, I said, this is the guy you got to get on those super regionals calling the games, and hopefully we'll get that done someday. But I travel in my professional life, and I do a lot of corporate speaking. I talk to CEOs and upper level management groups and Fortune 500 companies. And in my ESPN job, I travel and I become friends with a lot of college football, basketball, and baseball coaches over the years. And I've learned that really those two jobs are very similar in terms of what their goal is. Now, the means are different, but the goal is to win. And the similarities are significant because when you're hired to be a CEO of a major company or you're hired to be a head coach, you're normally not brought in because your predecessor retired. You're brought in because your predecessor didn't get the job done. And didn't endear himself to the people that mattered in that program. And you're handed the keys to a company, you're handed the keys to a program, and you said, turn it around. We need to win. Let's get us back on track. Now, when I've asked those CEOs, I said, what's the key? What's the key to making the difference? How do you turn it around? How do you become successful? And they all said the same thing. They all said there really isn't one specific recipe, one agenda or guideline item that works. However, there's a couple of overview things that everyone seems to use. These may sound familiar. And they said that, to a person they realize that when you came in and take over a company or a team, that the team obviously has a weakness in leadership, in attitude, in commitment, and talent. And so they go in and the guy says, okay, I'm here to take over the program, here to take over this big company. And hopefully the leadership problem has been solved. That's why I brought you here. Hopefully my team, my coaches, my management style will solve the leadership problem. But now I've got to work on the others. So year one, most of the time they will tell you, the corporate moguls will say that the thing you shouldn't do is you don't come in year one and clean house. You don't come in and change talent and personnel. It's you try to work from within. You try to work on the attitude. You want to instill a positive, I believe, upbeat, team-first kind of attitude. but also helps you identify the people in that program or in your company who have that air of selfishness and negativity. Those are the cancers you want to be able to find that are there. Now, year two, according to the corporate politics and the books you read, they say that's the year you go in and you make changes. You go in and you change personnel. And you, because you've ahead of time to identify the people that are a part of the problem and the people that replace them with people who want to be a part of the solution. That's given everyone a time to be able to turn around the difference. I remember one coach a few years ago told me that we were going to dinner one night. He said, I can't wait for May to get here so these kids can graduate. Because I inherited some kids on scholarship that I can't do anything about. But when they graduate in May, suddenly a lot of that defeatist attitude they've had is gone. Because that changes my program. You know, a couple of years ago, a very, very successful, high-profile college football coach in the South and I were doing some things together socially and asked him, I said, what are you doing this summer? And he said, I'm going to become an intern. I'm going to shadow a major CEO of a huge corporation in Atlanta, Georgia. And I asked him, why? I said, as successful as you've been, I said, all that you've won in college football at a high-profile program, he said, well, he says, I want to see his management style. He said, I wear a lot of hats, different hats. I'm trying to quote him. He said, I have to manage so many different groups of people. I want to watch and learn how he does it. You know, how does he know who to trust? How does he know when to delegate? How to make those difficult business decisions that may not be popular within his staff? And then conversely, he said, I've offered him a chance, if he wants to come walk on the sidelines with me in the SEC in the fall and see what he thinks. Well, I followed up with that coach a few months later, and I said, what'd you learn? He said, it's amazing to me. He said, when I'm not coaching, when I can take a step back and look at what he's doing, and he can take a step back and look at what I'm doing, we both decided that it's real simple, that you can, a small seed planted at this level can grow and deliver huge dividends down here if it's nurtured by an atmosphere of positivity. That's the key. If it is nurtured by an atmosphere of positivity. Ironically, it was an ESPN colleague of mine by the name of Lee Corso who told me a story years ago that best exemplifies that. Now, Lee, by the way, will be in town tomorrow. He is getting the Lindsey Nelson Award for Broadcasting. How appropriate we're here at Lindsey Nelson Stadium. He's getting the Lindsey Nelson Award for Broadcasting on Saturday morning. But it was 1973 when Lee Corso became the head coach of the University of Indiana. And after convincing wins early in the year over West Virginia and Kentucky, he was about to face top-ranked Ohio State. In his press conference during the bye week prior to the Ohio State game, Lee proclaimed that Indiana was no longer just a basketball school. It was time for the Hoosiers to take their rightful place as a contender in the Big Ten. And what better time to do that than right now, coming up next week against the number one team in the nation, the mighty Buckeyes of Ohio State. Well, as you might imagine, that didn't sit real well with the fiery Buckeye head coach by the name of Woody Hayes. Now, Woody hastily called his own press conference to tell any and all who would listen that this loudmouth in Indiana needs a history lesson. He said that his Buckeyes have never lost to Indiana, and in fact, he can't remember even ever trailing Indiana in a game, and he went on then to guarantee the fact that Indiana would not score a point against his dominant, stifling defense. Then he finished up by saying, once a basketball school, always a basketball school. Well, that's exactly what Lee Corso wanted to happen. He knew what was going to happen if he said, we're going to become relevant. And so he knew the Buckeye coach would come out and make all those guarantees and promises. Well, here comes game day. Ohio State wins the toss. Let me back up a second. I want to tell you what happened the following next week. So Lee decides the week of practice to fulfill his plan, okay? Prepared for the game, he closed his practices, and instead of working on his regular offense, his regular pro offense, he had served in about a dozen gadget plays. These were flea flickers, reverses, halfback passes, swinging gags, punt brewskis. The players thought it was fun, and they enjoyed it so much it kept their minds off of this punishing opponent they were about to play on Saturday. Okay, now game day. Ohio State wins the toss, and they elect to kick. They want to go on defense first so they can punish this Indiana team. They want to prove a point. They're playing in Bloomington, Indiana, by the way. First play from scrimmage is a dive play off tackle. bam, running back gets hit for a 2-yard loss. They're celebrating like crazy on the Ohio State sidelines. Woody Hayes is pumping his fist. They're making a statement. This is a basketball school. Second play, Lee Corso calls a toss, sweep, reverse, pitch, halfback pass to a flanker down the field and a lateral flea flicker to another wide receiver who runs 63 yards and scores. They kick the extra point at 7-0 in the end. Lee runs over to the official, calls timeout. The official says, look, so you don't need to call timeout. He said, you just scored a televised game, we're going to go to commercial, the clock has stopped. Lee said, no, I understand that. He said, but when you guys get that commercial, when you get ready to resume play, I want to call timeout. In fact, I want to use all three of my timeouts right now in succession. And the referee says, you got to be kidding me. He said, it's up to you. He said, I want to call all three timeouts in a row, so we'll get back to commercial. 1, 2, 3. Tell me when we're out of time, we'll get back and we'll kick it off. So Lee had a plan. Okay? Suddenly he runs his entire football team on the field in the end zone. They're lining up in the end zone. He's got the team photographer out there on a huge ladder on the 15-yard line taking a picture of his team lined up in the end zone. Everyone's standing nice and right. They practiced that week. And behind them, the scoreboard said, Indiana 7, Ohio State nothing. Woody Hayes is furious. Woody is furious. He's even more furious next week when he got that autographed picture from the team and all the team everybody was signed. But, you know, and of course, the final score for the game was 37-0 Ohio State. But Lee had a method to his madness. The reason Lee did what he knew he didn't have the talent or the depth to play with the mighty Buckeyes of Ohio State. He knew that. But he wanted to plant the seed. He wanted his kids to know that on a given play, we can be successful. We can beat these guys. And if we put enough of those plays together, we got a quarter. If we put two quarters together, we got a half. And eventually we'll have a game. And we'll play with these guys. The kids had a great time. The kids that were coming in had a great time. The recruits enjoyed it. And of course, it was a day where these guys realized alone that they made this Ohio State coach eat his words. Because now he had been behind to Indiana, and now Indiana had scored. So it was a difference. It was a difference. That's what he was trying to do. In 1980, an Italian, he calls himself an Italian, basketball coach from Queens, New York, was hired to take over North Carolina State University. On the first day, Jim Valvano did was tell his players when he got there that he wanted to win a national championship. And some of the media laughed, and some just rolled their eyes, but they all listened and remembered, especially the players, and especially the kids he was recruiting to come there. Now, he came to the Wolfpack Club Athletic Board. I was a member, I was on the board at the time. And I was the youngest guy on the board, and all the guys had been there for a long time. Already been and sat down in front of the chancellor and athletic director, and he said, what are you doing? Why do you walk in the door and tell everybody, the media, and everybody, that you're going to win a national championship? And Jimmy B said, well, quite honestly, he said, what do I tell these kids? Do I say you're going to go out there and you're going to play your tail off, and if you get really, really lucky, we're going to finish fourth in the ACC, right behind Dean Smith, North Carolina Tar Heels, Mike Krzyzewski's Duke boys, and the Virginia Cavaliers of Ralph Sampson. Well, I tell them that? No. I'll tell them we're going to come in here and we're going to win the ACC and we're going to win a national championship. He said, I believe that. At least once a month, Jim Valvano held a practice with no basketballs, no drills, no scouting report, no running. They all gathered in Reynolds Coliseum with scissors and hoisted each other up and practiced cutting down the nets. And he was the last guy to go up. They hoisted him up, he cut down the final net. Then they would put the nets around their necks. They would run around Reynolds Coliseum empty, Reynolds Coliseum, waving to the crowd, and then they would stop and chant and sing the fight song. Some thought in the media thought this was eccentric, ridiculous. Some believed it to be arrogant and absurd. But the players loved it, and so did the recruits who heard about it. And what Jimmy V was doing was what Lee Corso had done, was planting the seed. A seed to allow them to believe that when the time came, it would be their destiny. Now there's a made-for-TV movie, 30 for 30, called Survive and Advance, which is out, which chronicles that magical season in 1993. I happened to be there and be a part of it, knew Jimmy V personally, and it's exactly as he wanted it to happen. But I'm here today to tell you You don't have to watch a movie, those of you who haven't seen it, because it's happening right here in front of your eyes in Knoxville, Tennessee. Dave Serrano has come here and planted a seed. You can see it in the players' eyes, you can hear it in their voices, you can see it in their body language on the field. These players know that there are only 11 coaches in the history of college baseball that have taken more than one program to the College World Series, and their guy's one of them. These players know that their head coach has been to the College World Series 7 times, including his first time as an assistant here back in 1995. They know that Dave Serrano has been to the mountaintop. He knows that it takes leadership, commitment, attitude, and talent to get there. Year one, Dave came in, he's going to change the attitude, the mindset. And you can see the spark, the glimmers of laying the foundation to bring Tennessee baseball back. Wins over 5 different ranked teams. Half the teams in the College World Series field, he beat first year here. Year two, this year, it was time to make some changes in personnel. It's like the corporate people say, this is how you get this, this is how you win. It's how you turn it around. 21 of 32 players are new, 18 freshmen. 17 of those 18 have seen the field. The youngest team in college baseball in America. My boss at ESPN, who covers baseball, who's over all college baseball at ESPN, asked me, what's the deal? 17 freshmen have been on the field. I said, yeah, they've got Pampers in the bullpen. These kids are young, and they're inconsistent, but they're about to be great because they got a guy that's going to get them there. They won some battle early this year, beating nationally ranked Arizona State. They had back-to-back wins over a ranked team in Kentucky. And then, against number 2 Vanderbilt, they were in the game and had a chance to win for the final innings of every single game with a young ball club. Momentum was building. They've won 4 of the last 5 in a row on the road. And now these kids know, and I hope you know, I know, that with some consistent play down the stretch, these kids could get in the SEC tournament. And who knows? Maybe beyond. It's all about surviving in advance. Last fall at a fundraiser, actually, it was last August at a fundraiser in North Carolina. I sat with a lot of Major League players and some coaches, some Hall of Famers. But there was an active college baseball coach who's a friend of mine. He knows I live in Knoxville. He came up to me and he said, and his quote was, as much as I hate to admit it, it's going to happen in Knoxville. I don't know if he was talking about, you know, flood or tornado or what. He said it's going to happen in Knoxville. And he said, the University of Tennessee has it all. They got great facilities, passion, fan support. And now they've got Dave Serrano there. They've got the whole package. He said, in fact, and I'm quoting him, he said, the only thing they lack is patience. If they will be patient, he will take them exactly where they need to go. How's that? Remarkable praise from a coach who will have to play against this guy beating for an SEC title. He said, he later joked, said, that's the bad part. I got to beat this guy to win the league. He said, but here's the good part. He said, I know there's a good chance that down the road, when he gets this program exactly where he wants it to go, I get to see him again in Omaha. And then we get to tell America, because he's there and I'm there, how good SEC baseball really is. It's pretty good. Pretty good for a guy that's won 2 national championships. A lot of confidence. So here's my message today. University of Tennessee is on its way back. Dave Serrano will probably tell you all that he knows he's not where he needs to be. There are still some pieces of the puzzle that are missing, but there's so much excitement and energy and enthusiasm. My boss at ESPN calls and says, wow, guys, he's got it rolling. I said, they're just starting to get it rolling in Tennessee in baseball. Now it's up to me, it's up to you to spread the word that volunteer baseball is back. Dave Serrano has planted a seed. And if we all are patient and we nurture that seed with an atmosphere of positivity, just like Lee Corso and Jimmy Valvano, these kids and our fans know that they will take us where we want to go. So I challenge you today. How many of you ever heard of the Jocelyn Art Museum? Show of hands, have you ever heard of the Jocelyn Art Museum? Anybody ever heard of the Henley Dorley Zoo? How about the Strategic Air Command Museum? Okay. Well, I challenge you to read on those, because all 3 of those are located in Omaha, Nebraska. And I don't know how long it'll be. I don't think it'll be nearly as long as we think it'll be. but you're going to get a chance to go there. And during the off time, you can visit some of those places. And when you go, and when this man takes the Volunteers of Tennessee to the College World Series, he will become just the third coach in college baseball history to take three teams to the whole line. I don't know about you, but that gets me excited. Very excited. Thanks for having me today, folks.
That concludes today's program. We thank Dr. Punch and, of course, thank Coach Serrato for his comments today. Remind you, 6 o'clock Friday night, be here for Tennessee and Ole Miss. Bring some friends and be part of the start of that building dome. Thank you, and we'll see you in a couple weeks for our final luncheon.